Okay. How you guys doing?
Good.
Oh, good. So I have not been to GCR. The last time I was here was I taught a year and like a month ago. So I was 20, now I'm 21. So yes, we're making it up in life, and it's been good. This is really cool what's going on here. Like, this is the fact that I don't even know how many people we have here, but how cool is it that we can come together and listen and read the Word of God? Like, that is a privilege that I think we take for granted far too often. Like, this is really cool, and God has blessed us with this moment in this building. I haven't been in here a whole lot. It's so cool. It's new, if you guys didn't know. But my name is Isaac, what's interesting, I met a guy, sorry, this has nothing to do with what we're talking about, but this week I met a guy, and I asked him his name, and we were at the library, and he was like reading a bunch of things, and I sat down, I'm like, hey man, what's your name? And he looked at me, he's like, I don't have a name, because it takes away from the glory of God. I'm like, whoa, okay. So I sat down. What are you saying?
I think I know
it. Really?
Yes.
Have you seen him, like, read his Bible and stuff?
By the way,
does he have the thing still on his glasses? Yep. No way. So you've met him?
Oh, yes.
Have you talked to him?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. I talked to him for, like, me and Jordan, my wife in the back, and then my dad next to her. We talked. That's crazy. I'm going to talk to you after because I have some thoughts. That's cool. So this guy had no name. He wouldn't tell me his name. Asked him three times. Anyways, I'm Isaac. You want me to talk louder? Yes, I can talk. I can talk louder. Yeah. We're going to read the Bible. And so if you have your Bible, can you open to Matthew chapter 16, which is the gospel. It's one of the gospels. There's four of them. This is the first one that we're going to be looking at. And I think you guys have been going through Matthew chapter by chapter, which is really cool. And I have a question first. I need you guys to think back to when you were a child or when you were growing up. What was it like to be a student in school? If you just, you can start blurting out, what characteristics make up a student?
Lazy.
Lazy. Yep. Yeah. Okay, sitting at the front, nice. What else? Let's start rattling them off. What did you guys do?
Homework.
Homework, yep. Who'd you hang out with? Friends? Some of you guys did sports?
Detention.
Detention? Oh, yeah. Would you? You go to detention a lot?
I did.
Oh, yeah. I went to detention one time, and it was because I was playing tag. It's dumb. It wasn't a good idea. I was in middle school, so it wasn't good. Okay, so there are characteristics of somebody who is a student. And oftentimes what you're doing as a student is you're being taught and you're learning. Or you'd say, I'm a learner. What you may or may not realize is you are a student even now of something, of someone. You're constantly being taught and learning from something or someone. I don't know what that is. But we are constantly being shaped. And another word for that would be a disciple. So a disciple is this word that people throw around in the Christian faith. It essentially means a learner, a student, or someone who follows. And so we're going to look at what it means to be a disciple of Jesus, a follower of Jesus. And through the Gospels, you hear about this teacher, this rabbi, who at the time, in the culture, rabbis were seen as I don't know the best word to describe it, but they were like very held high at a high standard. It was a privilege to be a student of a rabbi. And a rabbi wouldn't just like, oh yeah, you can be mine. You'd like prove yourself to be a student of the rabbi. Jesus comes in and he's like anybody, and he starts pulling people like a fisherman and tax collector, and he starts preaching to everybody saying, you can come be my disciple. And so Jesus is is doing all of these things. And how many of you guys were here last week? Okay, quite a few of you. What was the last thing that Jesus did in Matthew 15? Does anybody know or remember? Fed 4,000 people. Okay, so that's crazy. I don't know if you guys thought about that. So Jesus, there were a bunch of people around him, and they were really hungry, and they're like, we need to be fed. And so Jesus feeds them, and the disciples are there. His followers are there. They're watching Jesus as he's doing these miracles, as he's doing these healings, as he's doing these teachings, and they're learning. They're being taught by Jesus. And so we get to Matthew 16, right after he leaves from feeding the 4,000, and he goes to another area, and the Pharisees and Sadducees come up to him again, and they test him. In verse 2, they ask him, or verse 1 in chapter 16, they asked him to show him a sign from heaven. He answered them, when is evening, you say, it will be fair weather, for the sky is red, and in the morning it will be stormy today, for the sky is red and threatening. You know how to interpret the appearance of the sky, but you cannot interpret the signs of the times. An evil and adulterous generation seeks for a sign, but no sign will be given to it except the sign of Jonah. So he left them and departed. Okay, so he's interacting with the Pharisees and Sadducees. And the Pharisees were these super religious people at the time. They you think of the rule followers in like high school, like the goody two shoes that did everything right, that did no wrong. Like these were the Pharisees, but they to the point where they wouldn't even interact with those who did wrong. Like they would clean everything that they touched and whatever. And so the Pharisees are seeking for a sign. And what's interesting is I think at times I don't think that's an invalid thing to do, because when somebody's doing crazy things, you want them to do them again. I don't know, I was even the other day asking for a sign, and I don't really know why. But Jesus says that I'm going to give you a sign of Jonah. He left them and departed. And when the disciples reached the other side, they had forgotten to bring any bread. Jesus said to them, watch and beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and Sadducees. And they began discussing it among themselves, saying, we brought no bread. But Jesus, aware of this, said, O you of little faith, why are you discussing among yourselves the fact that you have no bread? Do you not yet perceive? Do you not remember the 5 loaves for the 5,000 and how many baskets you gathered? Or the 7 loaves for the 4,000 and how many baskets you gathered? How is it that you fail to understand that I did not speak about bread? Beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and Sadducees. Then they understood that he did not tell them to beware of the leaven of bread, but of the teaching of the Pharisees and Sadducees. So going back to what I was talking about earlier, how we're constantly being taught, right? We're being learned. We are learning from something or someone. So I don't know if you can picture it, but Jesus is this teacher. He's saying, hey, don't listen to these people. Don't listen to the teachings that they give because they're corrupt. They're not right. And you see this and polarizing contrast between the Pharisees and Sadducees. And we don't have time to get into why they were, just because we're limited on time here. But Jesus is going to go into what it means to follow him. And if you were to listen to Jesus, this is the life that would come out of it. And we're just going to keep going. When Jesus came to the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, who do people say that the Son of Man is? And they said, some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and others Jeremiah or one of the prophets. And he said to them, but who do you say that I am? Who do you say that I am? Simon Peter replied, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. We're going to pause right there. This is one of like the most important questions, I think, that we as readers and as followers of whatever need to ask. This question is a culmination of everything that's been going on in Jesus' life. So if you've been paying attention as these weeks have gone on, Jesus is doing these things and he's making these claims and he's making these statements. So then he asks, who do people say that I am? Which is interesting. And people say John the Baptist. Are you guys familiar with John the Baptist? Yes? No? So John the Baptist was this homeless guy living in the woods who comes out and starts like proclaiming that somebody's coming. He starts dunking people in water and everyone's come out to see what's going on. And then he starts like going after this king and gets thrown in jail. So he's in jail at this point. So like, are you that guy? Well, actually, did he die? How are you? Then he says, are you Elijah? You guys know who Elijah is? Prophet? Yep. Do you know what he did? So Elijah was this guy in the Old Testament who was called by God to speak to these wicked kings. And he did crazy miracles. He made a vase of bread last like a long, long, long time. He laid on this child like three times. He like laid down on him and he like resurrected because he was super sick. There's a super famous story of Elijah of this altar. And he calls out Baal, which was this other god. He called out Baal and he said, come get all your people and make an altar and I'm going to make my altar. And whoever's god is real is going to light the thing on fire. Well, what happens is God sends fire and lights the whole thing up. And then at the end of Elijah's life, he ascends. God takes him. So people are like, are you Elijah? Because at the end of Malachi, which is the end of the Old Testament, actually, we could flip there. I'll flip there real quick. Super fascinating. So the end of Malachi, he says, behold, I will send you Elijah, the prophet, before the great and awesome day of the Lord comes, and he will turn the hearts of fathers to their children and the hearts of children to their fathers, lest I come and strike the land with the decree of utter destruction. So people at the time are like, are you Elijah? Jesus, are you Elijah who God is going to come and like proclaim your new kingdom? And then other people are like, are you a prophet? And in Deuteronomy, there's this prophet that Moses says that somebody's going to come after me who's better than me. And he's going to lead the people right. And so people are asking, like, who is Jesus of Nazareth? And that's the disciples' response. Then he asks his followers. He asks his followers, who do you say that I am? Now, if you and Peter responds. So Peter was one of the 12. And what I was thinking about and what was so cool to think about was up until this moment, Peter, he was a fisherman. Jesus comes up to him and says, hey, I'm going to make you a fisher of men. Follow me. So Peter leaves his stuff. And now he has no idea what's going to happen with this life of Jesus. And he starts following Jesus. And what he sees is this guy who claims to be the Son of God, who seeks not the political leaders, but the lowly, the outcast, the lepers, the mute. And he starts being super intentional and loving them and healing them. And Peter's right there watching. And then he watches as Jesus goes up to this mountain and proclaims this new way of living. This sermon on the mountain, as it's talked. He's sitting there listening to Jesus' teachings. And then he goes, and then remember the story of Peter walking on water? It's the same guy who's right here. So Peter sees his rabbi walking on water. And Peter goes, hey, if this is you, tell me to come out, and I'll start walking with you. And so Peter starts walking on water, and as he's sinking, Jesus pulls him out. And so he's Peter, and then he sees the feeding of the 4,000 and the healings again, and all of these things are culminated into this moment where Jesus is asking, "Who do you say I am?" And Peter, without hesitation, goes, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." That's a big statement. That is a very big statement. The Christ means Messiah, or anointed one. And so in the Old Testament, there are this thing called anointing oil. So anointing oil was what God had Moses make so that he could pour onto certain things. Vessels, people, and certain people, this oil would be poured onto. Priests, prophets, and kings. So priests were in charge of all the sacrificial systems in the tabernacle. And so they were anointed with oil. They were christened. I don't know if that's the right word. Anointed upon. And then you have prophets. Some of the prophets were anointed. And then kings. King David was anointed with oil. And so that anointing, it was a symbol, it was a super symbolic symbol of like God's representative for the people. And so this idea in the Old Testament was that some king through the line of David would be this ultimate prophet, priest, king, this Messiah, the anointed one. That one day this guy was going to come and he was going to bring God's justice, to bring God's righteousness, to bring in the new kingdom of God. And so everybody's waiting and waiting and waiting for this guy to show up. And everyone's asking. They even asked John the Baptist, "Are you the Christ? Are you the Messiah? Are you the one we're waiting for?" He's like, "No, no, no. I'm not the Christ. There's somebody that's going to come after me who is. He who is the one to come," right? And so here, Jesus says, "Who do you say I am?" And Peter says, "You are the Messiah. You are the Christ. You're the guy we've been waiting for based on everything he's seen." Yeah, I mean, we could go way deeper, but there's nothing for it. This claim is that Jesus is the Messiah. And so you either can take it as is, or you can walk away from it. We're gonna go into that later. We're going to keep reading, and then we're going to kind of unpack it at the end. Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Then he strictly charged the disciples to tell no one that he was the Christ. And from that time, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed, and on the third day be raised. And Peter, the disciple still, took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, "Far be it from you, Lord. This shall never happen to you." But he turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a hindrance to me, for you are not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of man." Then Jesus told his disciples, "If anybody would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. And what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and forfeits his soul? Or what will a man give in return for his soul? For the Son of Man is going to come with his angels in the glory of his Father, and then he will repay each person according to what he has done. Truly, I say to you, there are some standing here who will not taste death until they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom." Oof. Okay, that's a lot. A lot to unpack, and there's only so much time that we have. And so there is a specific verse, a couple of verses that I want to highlight, and this is where we're going to spend the rest of our time. I mentioned at the beginning a follower or a learner, a student, you're being taught. Jesus comes and he chooses 12 followers, disciples. And we have this scene of when his follower just claims that, dude, you are the Son of God. And right after that, Jesus says, hey, I am, you're right, blessed are you, Simon. But I'm going to suffer. I'm going to die, but I'm going to raise from the dead. And Peter, what's he do? He rebukes Jesus and then gets rebuked by Jesus. And then he says this, that one of the most important things that and has convicted me so much. If anybody would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. Dude, what? I mean, if you just sit and soak for a minute, like, if anybody would come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. What's Jesus saying? That's profound. That's not like, hey, if you want to follow me, you just got to do this homework and you're good. But actually, Jesus is asking so much more. It's a extremely important statement. And so Jesus says that if you want to follow me, if you want to be my disciple, you have to deny, or if you want to come after me, this person has to deny himself. What does it mean to deny yourself? Yourself naturally wants life. You want things, you have emotions, you have hobbies, you have all these things, right, that you desire. You have cravings, you have thoughts, you have dreams, you have visions, you have family, friends. Okay, so that's like yourself. He says, Jesus says that you have to say no to that, and that you have to take up your cross and follow me. When you think of the word cross, what comes to mind? Death, suffering. Sacrifice, yep. Do you guys know what the cross looked like? It was this, there are actually three different kinds of crosses. But the one that Jesus was on, when Jesus foretells his death, he said, hey, I'm going to go suffer at the chief priest and be killed, and on the third day be raised. So this cross, the cross represented death, suffering, shame, humility, insane pain, unbearable pain. And Jesus says that you have to pick that up and follow me. Dude. What? The cross, I mean, what? I mean, how do I even do that? Jesus, you're asking me to partake in something that you've already done. If you don't know the story of the gospel, if you don't know the story of Jesus, and what Jesus claims here is, he did die on a cross, right? He did. He did die. He did suffer. It was this super humiliating thing. Jesus was naked and exposed on this cross, which I was talking to Jordan, or I don't know if it was Jordan or whatever, but he was naked and exposed. He was experiencing shame. If you go to Genesis, sorry, this is a sidetrack. If you go to Genesis, Adam and Eve, before they ate of the fruit, they were naked and what? Unashamed. They ate of the fruit, and what happened? They knew they were naked. And that they were ashamed. They hid. They clothed themselves. So here's Jesus, the second Adam, as Paul talks about, who is bare naked, bearing the shame of sin, exposed for all of humanity. That's wild. I was thought, oh yeah, we're geeking out about that stuff. But this is what is going on. And Jesus dies for sin. He had no sin, none. And he took upon all of our sin. This is what he was working towards, so that we can have life. And it wasn't until the resurrection that we can actually receive life. But in order for there to be a resurrection, there has to be a death. Right? So in order for you to live, again, you have to die. But if you think about it literally, it's impossible for you to die and be resurrected in this life, right? I don't think. I haven't heard of anybody who's killed themselves and resurrected, right? I mean, like, so is that what he's asking? I don't think so. I think it's something deeper. I think there's something that Jesus is trying to get at. Because in order to deny yourself, you have to die to yourself. Right? So you have to put to death your desires, who you are. And it sounds like this super broken, vulnerable state, right? Like, what? I have to die to who I am? Like, what does that even look like? What's that even look like to die, deny yourself, right? It's this like weird thought process that's like, okay, what's that even mean? It's the idea of surrendering and giving up of who you are. Taking like your crown and laying it down. And so what Jesus is saying is like, when you, to follow me, you have to lay down your crown and place them at the feet. And then you have to go and take up this super painful, broken cross that you're going to die. This is the life of a Jesus follower. It's almost as if Jesus was saying, hey, for you, if you want to be my disciple, you are going to suffer. It's going to be really hard. You're going to be shamed. And like even thinking through this now, it's so hard to imagine that living in America. I don't know. Like, we don't experience that kind of persecution here. And I was talking to John, my buddy. I'm like, dude, how do you get up and share something like that when we can't even relate to that kind of suffering? But I don't think that's the point. I think there's a deeper point that Jesus is trying to get at. When you give your life to Jesus and when you start following him, you will experience opposition. You experience forms of suffering. You experience kinds of rejection. You experience kinds of pain. And it is through those things, through the cross bearing, that you will receive life, which is what Jesus says. He says, for whoever would save his life is going to lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. It's so bizarre that Jesus is saying this, because it doesn't make any sense logically. It makes no sense. And yet it's one of the most profound things that only people who have experienced it and done it can recognize and accept. But the prophet Jeremiah, he was prophesying to one day when God would remove the hearts of stone and give them a new heart and write the law on their heart and place God's spirit within them. Well, that time is now. You see, when you maybe this is your first time hearing about this Jesus guy, and you're like, what in the world is Isaac talking about? Like cross, death, resurrection, like this is nuts. Praise God if you're here. Maybe this is like your second or third time hearing about Jesus, or maybe you've been following Jesus for a long time. What's interesting is what Jesus asks. In order to follow Jesus, you have to first die to yourself. And what Jesus promises, and it's through his resurrection, because if you believe the gospel that Jesus died on a cross for your sins and that he put to death the sin that was in you that you had no ability to do, and if you believe what Paul says about how you were dead in your sin, you are incapable of giving life. You're dead. You're already dead. So the only thing you have to do is accept it. You have to accept the fact that you are dead and incapable of life. But then Jesus comes in and he says, guys, I resurrected from the grave and now offer this life, this new humanity, to everybody and anybody. And it's when you deny yourself, when you lay your crown down at Jesus' feet and believe that his atoning blood cleanses you and washes you clean, that you can experience new life. It's the resurrection of your soul, which is what Paul talks about, how the old has passed away and the new has come, because God now gives you a new heart. He gives you a new mind. And it's like what baptism represents, right? It's the idea of dying and resurrecting. That can happen now. And it's so cool and so profound And Jesus is offering this new kind of life, though. And in the Gospel of Mark, he talks about how you have to die and carry your cross daily. It's this daily surrender. It's this daily surrender of what you think life is and laying it at the feet of Jesus and following what Jesus says is life, which might at times look like death. Following Jesus at times will look like death. But it's knowing that it's through death, it's through the doorway of death that you will inherit life. Even in reality. And even like you think about Moses. Moses who has like Pharaoh and his army coming at him. And he sees this big old sea of water. And they do, we're dead. Like it looks like death. But God, through his amazing power and glory, splits the sea wide and they go through the other side. But it was Moses' faith in God's providential hand in the moment that saved him. So even though Moses saw the water and saw the impending death, it was God who came in and rescued him from that. So for us, we are dead without Jesus Christ. We are dead. We are surrounded by death. And there's no way. Everywhere we look is death. But Jesus is the one who split the sea for us, who split the water so that we can walk through. He is another way to describe atonement, or not atonement, anointing or oil, is this idea of a bridge between God and man. Because oil is like this substance. It's the life juice of a plant, like squeezed out and formed into this oil. So it's like, I don't know, tons of symbols. But this bridge idea, this representative between God and man, Jesus claims to be that bridge. Jesus claims to be that bridge, being, hey, I am the doorway to eternal life. Nobody can come to the Father except through me. And it's those, only those who can deny themselves, die to themselves, that can enter into me, because it's those who I give my life. And so I don't know where you guys are at in your Jesus following life. But I will say two things. One, Jesus absolutely loves you and sympathizes with you. It's talked about how Jesus is this great high priest who is not able to sympathize with, who is not able to, or who's able to sympathize with all of our weaknesses because he experienced it. And then two, that following Jesus is the best life. It's the greatest life. And I mean, I could sit up here and talk. But I think, what are we doing at 7:10?
Yeah.
And so if you have questions about who in the world this Jesus guy is, you have to talk to somebody about it. Because I only talked for 25 minutes and we just scratched the surface at who Jesus is and what he claimed to do. But guys, there is so much depth and there's so much density and so much love in who Jesus embodies and what he came to do. And there are people in this room who would absolutely love to talk to you that you need to go to. You need to repent right now of your sin and turn to Jesus. I remember when Jesus first stepped into the scene, he went around and telling people to repent because the kingdom of God is here. Well, guys, the kingdom of God is here and now. And you have the ability to experience life in this moment right now. And so I don't know if that's you. That was me. And when I encountered Jesus, I experienced life. And it was an unbelievable moment. There's so much more that we could have talked about. But we're running out of time. And I'm just going to pray and ask that I hope this brings up just a lot of questions, because that's what we're here for. Just a lot of questions, a lot of wondering, what in the world was he talking about? And hopefully you can do that in your small group time or even meet with somebody. And so I'm going to pray and then we'll break out. Father, you're so good and so gracious. And we have no way to step into your presence, to experience your love, but you, through your great grace and great mercy gave your Son, your only Son, to show us what it means to live. And Father, would you help us to follow you, to deny ourselves and take up our cross and walk the path, the narrow road that leads to life. And would you help us follow you, and would you give us direction and understanding, and for those who have questions, would you answer them? Father, I thank you for everybody here, and would you bless this room, and would you be with us as we move forward and through life. And I ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.